Now we have we've come to an important time of our worship and where we hear God's word. Today we have a very special guest. We have David Wong, a dear friend of mine, a dear friend of Pastor Elisha's, and he's ministered to us and served our church in many ways. He was our camp speaker last year, and we want to just thank him that he's decided to come on again. You know, after many years serving in and working in Tupperware, he's gained pearls of wisdom, which he is so willingly able to share with all of us. So if you want to know how to find some measure of success, either in your business, in your life, and how God's word is relevant to us on a day-to-day basis at our work, listen to David Wong now, because he's going to share his wealth of experience taken from Psalm chapter 1. Over to you, David.
Good morning, New Covenant Community Church. It's been a long time since I met you all. The last we met was in May of last year in Cameron's at your church camp. And when Reverend Elisha invited me to come and speak to you all, I was really excited. I was really looking forward to meeting you all. But because the CMCO and the MCO and the COCO, whatever, it's just not possible. But nevertheless, I look forward to having this spending this time with you this morning. The CMCO, the COVID-19 has been very tough for most people. And I know of a young man, for example, who salary was cut by 40% and he's struggling to make ends meet. I was involved in an interview 2 weeks ago to helping a company interview for a financial controller. And this lady, she had a salary cut by 15%, and then 3 months later, 25%. And she told us that she's a single mother taking care of two teenage children and really struggling. I also work with businessmen, and some of them are struggling with the business, making lots of losses. Some have 2,000 staff, some 150 staff. They sleep very little in the night. They wake up in the middle of the night feeling very painful in the chest, stress. Some of them sleep only 2-3 hours a night. And I journey with them and walk through with them in these tough, challenging times. And then the question that comes to us, of course, at such a time is, are you still experiencing the peace of God? Are you still rejoicing in the Lord? Is the Lord still real? So this morning, I'd like to us to go into the book of Psalm. Psalm 1, examine what the Lord has for us. But before we do that, could you join me in bow your head and pray and commit this time to the Lord? Father God, I just pray that this morning, as we go through the your book of Psalms in Psalms 1, may your truth come alive for us, because your word is a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. And now may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable to you. And that this morning we can draw inspiration, encouragement, and comfort and direction for our lives. So we just commit this morning to you and ask that your Spirit Himself will teach us all things concerning yourself. In Jesus' precious name. Amen. If you have your Bible, you turn with me to Psalm chapter 1. Psalm 1, and I'm reading from the English Standard Version. Psalm 1, 1-4. Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, nor stand in the ways of sinners, nor sit in the seats of scoffers. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. He is like a tree that is planted by streams of water, that yields its fruit in its season, and its leaf does not wither. In all that he does, he prospers. The wicked are not so, but are like chaff that the wind drives away. Psalm 1, 1-4. You know, if you ask people, what is their passion or desire or goal for life? Most people tell you something like that. I want to be happy, you know. Happy, the word blessed, the first word of the book of Psalm is the word blessed. Blessed really means happy. And you ask people what they want in life, they say they want to be happy. And you, okay, if you ask them a bit further, what does happiness mean to you? It usually has to do with owning something. You know, say if I only have that car, the special car, or if I had that person's salary, or if I own that dream house, then I'll be happy. For some, it is to do with a relationship. if I only can marry that girl, then I'll be very happy. For some, might be, if I did not marry that girl, I'll be happy. Whatever it is, you know, happiness is what most of us aspire to. In the US, in the Gallup poll, they found out that more than 70% of Americans are unhappy. In Malaysia, the latest happiness index, there's a happiness index that's measured how happy people are in the country, and based on various factors, whether they're happy with the governance and the political situation, their jobs, the economics, environment and so forth. Malaysia happiness index, the latest in 2020, is 5.38, which is a significant drop from 2018, where it was the highest. And we were ranked about number 58 in the world. We are below countries like Kazakhstan, Pakistan, even some others, new developing country. We are ranked number 58 in the world. So by and large, Malaysians are not very happy, sad to say. So in this Psalm, Psalm 1, it says, blessed is a man who does not. It started by telling us three does not, three decline. And just in case you think that the Bible is very negative, start with no. Think about it a little bit more. You know, everything we need to say no before we can say yes. Think of the athlete. He has to say no to certain food, to ice cream, and to all the sweaty food, so that he can be the best athlete that he can be. Apostle Paul said in Philippians 3, I count everything as loss that I may gain Christ. You need to lose something in order to gain something. Or in Ephesians 4, it says, put off the old nature that you may put on the new nature. So we have to put off something in order to put on something. You have to say no before we can say yes. So the Bible is not negative. We start off with three declines, but then they end up with one delight. So three declines. The first thing is, blessed is the man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked. Does not walk in the counsel. You know, there are two ways we can respond. Some people, they will not listen to any counsel. They're so independent, they will say no to any counsel. And such a person obviously is not wise and definitely not happy. But there are the other extreme, there are others who listen to everyone's advice. You know, during the COVID and MCO period, you know, some of the people that I'm mentoring and working with, they will be running from one Zoom to the next Zoom and to another Zoom to another Zoom, trying to listen to all kinds of counsel. You know, with the human potential movement, with this self-improvement movement, with this positive thinking, everybody is looking for some motivation talks, some motivational tips, inspirational tips here. They'll be listening to this guru, that sifu, this coach. Everybody has a coach. Everybody has a guru. And the motivation tips, and then we'll be running for a TED talk, and some people will listen all day long to Oprah Winfrey, but they never go to God for counsel. So the Bible tells us, blessed is a man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked. Secondly, he does not stand in the path of sinners. You know, this is a progression from walking, then it's to standing. Standing has the idea of lingering, loitering, just hanging out. In 1 Corinthians 15, the Apostle Paul said in verse 33, he said, do not be deceived. Bad company corrupts good morals. So when you walk and you get used to all this counsel and to these people, before long, you're standing with them, hanging around with them, yeah, and getting more and more like them. Now, I must make it clear, I must balance what I said with, you know, it doesn't mean that we don't go to seek for advice, do not mix with non-believers. Some non-believers, they are extremely smart and wise. They can give us a lot of advice, technical advice, and good counsel. And Jesus is a friend of sinners and tax collectors. And the difference is whether we influence them or they influence us. The people who move the world are the people who could influence others, not let others influence us. So we need to be among non-believers. That's our calling, to go into the world and preach the gospel, to go into the world and make disciples. But there's a difference between trying to reach out to them with the intention of bringing them to the kingdom. It's another thing to stand around with sinners and be deceived by the bad company. So from walking, then we go to standing, and then we become sitting You know, you see how the progression is slowed down, and before long, you're sitting around among the seat of mockers. So someone tells us, blessed is a man, happy is a man who does not walk in the counsel of the wicked, does not stand in the path of sinners, nor sit in the seats of mockers. Who are mockers? Mockers are, to mock is to complain, to tease, or insult, or to scorn. Usually mockers scorn at God, you know. Their comments are toxic and bitter. So some of the non-believer might mock the Christian and say, see, now we are in COVID-19 and your company is in a big mess and you're losing lots of money. Where's your God? They've been mocked. But Galatians 6:7 says, do not be deceived. God cannot be mocked. A man reaps what he sows. So there are three declines. Do not walk in the counsel of the wicked. Do not stand in the path of sinners. And do not sit in the seat of mockers. Three declines. When we decline this, we are in the first step towards being blessed. But besides the decline, someone also tells us to take delight. Three declines, but one delight, only one delight. Verse two, it tells us, but whose delight is in the law of the Lord, and on his law he meditates day and night. Notice the word but, the preposition. There's a contrast. Do not but delight. Do not associate, do not walk in their ways, do not sit in their seats, but take delight. Delight in the law of the Lord. Notice it's a delight. It's not a duty. Oh, I got to read the Bible every morning. It's not a duty, not a drudgery. Oh, I got to do this homework, this Bible study. Next week, got cell meeting. It's not a drudgery, but it's a delight. Jeremiah 15:16 said, thy word were found, and I ate them, and they became a delight to my heart. My youngest daughter is married to an American, and they are living near Philadelphia in the U.S. And recently, I brought my wife for her birthday before the lockdown to a nice hotel to have a nice dinner. And I sent these photos to my daughter. My daughter said, oh, I'm going to miss that, you know. But she said, no, but what I really miss, what is really the delight to my heart is the asam laksa and the nasi lemak and the roti canai. That's the delight, you know. The hawker food is the delight of a stomach, you know. So that's the kind of idea that we should take delight in the law of the Lord. And he said, on his law, he meditates day and night. You know, what you read and what you meditate on is what you become. You know, to meditate is to chew over it, to enjoy it. You know, just like a cow chew over the grass and munch and chew and savor the taste, and then before it's digest it, to chew and mull and think through and talk through regarding the scriptures that you read. What does it say? What does it mean? How do I apply? How does this relate to my current situation? To meditate on it. I remember once I was promoted as a regional vice president. And besides being the CEO of Tupperware Malaysia, I was also in charge of Singapore and Indonesia and Thailand and Philippines. So I traveled quite a fair bit. And so because Indonesia is so big, I tend to spend quite a lot of time there trying to build up the business. And so I left the day-to-day operation to my financial controller. My financial controller is a very smart lady, very, very smart and dynamic. But she's a little bit a bit tough. And that was during the financial meltdown when we were trying to save costs. And we have an office and warehouse in Glen Marie. And we are situated on a 4.5-acre land. And I have a basketball court. I have a games room for my staff. And I have more than excess space for my staff. And so to help reduce costs, we're thinking of moving our premises, rented premises, to a smaller place. We were on 4.5 acres, and we were paying more than close to 150,000 of rental a month. So we thought we'd move to a smaller place. But in the course of the negotiation, I don't know how my financial controller upset the landlord, and then they sent a lawyer's letter to us. And then I consulted my lawyer, and they want us to dismantle all the renovation that we've done, and restore everything, break up the basketball court and so forth. It doesn't make sense. It's because of anger, not because of the desire to hit back, vengeful anger. So I consulted my lawyer. My lawyer said they have every right to ask you to do that. Then I consulted my friend who is not only a lawyer, but he's the president of the arbitration board in Malaysia. And his advice to me is that, you know, they have every right to tell you to do that. This is what I will coach you to do. This is how you negotiate. Let's go and negotiate with them, and you be as tough as possible. And then you give in one, give in a little, and then give some more, and then you stop there. And so we came up with a strategy on how to negotiate. And so he coached me, and then he said, I'll go with you for the negotiation as well. So the next week, when we were about to go for the negotiation, he said, remember, David, you know, you are the chief negotiator, and we'll back you. So, but in the morning, as we were on the way to the office to negotiate with the landlord, the Lord just brought back to my mind a Proverbs, in Proverbs 15, it says, a harsh word stirs up anger, but a gentle answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger. Wow, the Holy Spirit just brought this. It's a rhema word for me. Now I thought, well, rather than go in and hard-nosed negotiation, how about I just go in and apologize for what we've done, you know, the harsh word that my controller has said to the landlord. And so I told my arbitrator, you please wait here for about 10, 15 minutes. I go in first, I come back. He said, no, we shouldn't do that. I said, no, you please wait. So I went in there, apologize, and then within 5 minutes, we make up. And then I don't have to do any renovation, tear down the renovation, and we reconcile, and we just a status quo, and we didn't have to spend hundreds of thousands to reconstruct the whole place. Yeah, so you know, but because the my friend is a trained arbitrator and lawyer, that is how he thinks. That's how what he meditates on. But the Lord can guide us even in decisions like that as we take delight in His law. Joshua 1:8 tells us that this book of the law shall not depart of your mouth, but you shall meditate on it day and night, that you may be careful to do according to all that is written in it. For then you shall make your way prosperous, and then you shall have good success. What's the key to being prosperous and successful? Meditate on the Word of God day and night. Because in the Word of God, you get knowledge, you get understanding, and you get wisdom. Meditating on the Word of God. And that's all we need. One delight. Three declines, one delight. Even no matter what circumstances we are going through. So if we have these three declines and this one delight, and the Bible depicts as a result, it describes or depicts who is a man who is blessed. He will be, in verse 3, a person who is like a tree planted by streams of water that yields its fruits in season, whose leaf does not wither, and whatever he does, he prospers. A tree, and depicted in four outcomes of blessing. First, he is planted. The idea of planted is being stable, solid, firmly rooted. In fact, the New American Standard Version, this used the word firmly rooted. Firmly rooted, firmly planted. Now, during the COVID-19 really shook many people. I was telling you earlier that some of the businessmen that work with, they wake up in the middle of the night feeling pain in their chest, and they go to see the cardiologist, and the cardiologist found nothing wrong with them. And then some of them wake up at night, couldn't sleep, they sleep for 1 or 2 hours. And we did all kinds of things. So finally, I say, well, one of them confessed to me, say, for the last 3 to 4 months, I've not read a single chapter of the Bible. And my wife has been bugging me to get back to the Word of God. So I said, that's what we should do. So I begin to help them with a devotional life, and taught them a new way of doing a devotion, and that really encouraged them and reignite the fire for the Lord. And now they're calm again, you know. They're able to strategize and think, because the Word of God says in Psalm 119:105, thy word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. When you can see where your next step is, when you can see your path lighted up, you'll be calm, and you can think clearly, and then you'll be okay, you'll be stable, and you can work out the next strategy that's needed for your next move. So we need to be planted. So if we take delight in the Lord, we'll be like a planted tree with firmly deep rooted roots. Yeah. Secondly, a second outcome is we'll be fruitful. You know, production naturally follows being planted and rooted. Especially rooted deeply, we can draw nourishment and water by the streams of water. Yeah. Yeah, I used to live in a house. We have a huge mango tree. It grows taller and taller and taller. So big that when my children were young, we were able to put a papasan up there and just enjoy a picnic up there, you know. So it's such a huge tree. And it bears lots of fruit. Production naturally follows being planted and rooted. You know, I used to help a young businessman, Tan. He's one of my neighbor. He speaks very little English, and I'm a banana. I cannot speak Mandarin. I can't speak Cantonese. But he became a Christian, and asked me to help him. So I did, and I began to do Bible study with him, simple Bible study, and I taught him how to read the Word of God, and I teach him how to memorize scriptures. And during the financial meltdown, one year, our business was very bad, and there was some time like August or September, and our business was about 30% below plan. And I have been a managing director for many years. I have a lot of experience. I tried this strategy, that tactics, and I tried these action plans, and nothing works. One day I was going to work, Tan just text me a verse, Psalm 65:11. It says, "And I will crown you with abundance. Even your dry places will be filled with plenty." Well, it's like God speaking to my heart, like a word of God dropped into my soul. And I went to the office, I got my marketing director to the editor, and then we talked and we shared, and then we came out with three ideas. And I got my whole management team together, and I said, well, you know, we are way behind our plan, and we are 30% behind plan, and we cut short our production in the factory. And but you know, I've talked to the marketing director, and this is what we thought we would do. These are the three things we do. So I tell my production manager, we'll increase back the production to more than 30%, because I believe we'll achieve our year's plan. He said, we cannot get the raw materials, because our raw materials are of a different grade that we can't get easily in Malaysia. I said, well, import from Korea. He said, well, we have to pay duty. I said, well, 5% duty is not much. And then my sales director said, wow, you know, I have to mobilize all the salespeople. It's a bit rush. I said, let's try. Don't say no, try first. And then my finance director, my strong, firm finance director says, David, if we produce all these things and we can't sell, then all our money and cash will be tied up in stocks. I say, no, you will sell. He said, why this morning are you so insistent? You are usually not like that. So I have no choice but to tell them about Psalm 65:11. So when I say that, they don't argue with me anymore. So we put our shoulder to the work, and then we all try our best. You know what? We finish a year not only meeting our plan, we far exceeded our plan. And we max out on our profit. And many of them max out on their bonus. They get 4 months, 6 months, and everybody happy. So now whenever there's a drop in sales, my Singapore branch manager, who is a committed Christian, will ask, hey boss, got any more promises from God or not? So you see, when we are rooted in the Word of God, we'll be fruitful. Fruitful not only in breakthrough results, but fruitful also in maybe fruits of character, fruits of evangelism, you know. I remember not too long ago, a few months ago, my wife and I were just having some time together at a cafe, and then we heard someone sharing with another man behind, say, come to my church, you know, got Christmas. And the guy said, no, I don't want to go to church. All that. See, but I say, hey, you hear the conversation, why don't you go and join them? I say, they're all strangers, so I don't know them. See, my wife said, never mind, you go. So I did. At the urging of my wife, I went to talk to them. And within 15 minutes, I shared with him the gospel, and then I led the other man to Christ in a cafe itself. He bowed his head and prayed, accept Christ. So because I've been claiming this as I'm aging, as I'm growing older and older, a promise in Psalm 92 has been very, very, very meaningful. Psalm 92 verse 12, it says that you shall flourish like the palm, and you shall grow strong like the cedar of Lebanon. And verse 14 say, you continue to bear fruit in old age. Well, I won't call myself old, but getting there, you shall bear fruit in old age and remain vital and green. Isn't that wonderful? So I just went to share, and within 15 minutes, He agreed to bow down his head and pray to accept Christ, you know, bearing fruit, fruit of career success, fruit of business, fruit breakthrough, fruit of evangelism. Because his promises releases life. Yeah, when we are planted, his word stabilizes us. When we are planted, when we are rooted, we are fruitful, and his promises, the word of God, releases life. So he who take delight in the law, and meditate on it day and night, is like a tree planted, which bears its fruits in season, and whose leaf does not wither. He's planted, he's fruitful, he's unwithered. You know, the word of God is a tremendous encouragement through times of challenge and difficulties. Isaiah 43 says, when you walk through the water and the rivers, you will not be drowned. When you went through the fire, you will not be burned. Isn't that wonderful? The word of God is an anchor in the storms of life, and how we need the word of God if more than ever during this time of COVID-19 and lockdown. Yeah. And not only that, planted, fruitful, unwithered, but also in whatever thing he does, he prosper. Now, I was telling you about some of these businessmen who are struggling in their business and struggling in their life. And they begin, after they settled and restored their relationship with the Lord, they begin to reset their business plan. And some of us can reset our career goals and fulfill God's goals for our life. Yeah, Jeremiah 29:11 say, for I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. Plan for welfare and not for evil, to give you a future and a hope. Yeah. So the word of God instill hope and promises a wonderful future. The word of God stabilizes. The word of God releases life. The word of God anchors us in the storms of life. And the word of God instills hope and future for us. Take delight in the law, my friend. Take delight in the Lord. Meditate on it day and night, that you'll be like a tree, planted, fruitful, unwithered, and prosperous. The opposite, of course, is in verse 4. It says, not so the wicked, they are like chaff that the wind blows away. Well, chaff is the outer husk, the brown outer husk around a grain of rice or around a grain of wheat. And the wind comes, it just blow away, just go away. It'll be blow here, blown there. It has no stability. It's not fruitful. And before long, it withers and dies. Yeah, it will not prosper. But not so a man who is planted like a tree, because he takes delights in the Lord. So tree declines. Do not walk in the counsel of the wicked. Do not stand in the way of sinners. And do not sit in the seats of scoffer. Instead, take delight. Enjoy, take delight in the word of the Lord and meditate on it day and night. For therein you find wisdom, you find understanding, and you find guidance for your life. And you will be planted fruitful and prosper. Let's just bow and pray and ask the Lord to reveal to us the inspiration and the application that he wants us to draw from this truth that is revealed to us, that we might be doers of the word and not hearers only. And so in a moment of quiet and silence, you just speak to the Lord. What is that one thing? What is that one word? What is that one action? What is that application that the Lord has laid on your heart? How can you take greater delight in his word? In what way can you meditate on his word day and night? If you don't have that desire, pray and ask God for that hunger. Like Jeremiah said, thy words were found, and I ate them, and the word became a joy to my heart. So in just a moment, will you reflect and will you respond and ask the Lord to help you? Father, you know the secrets of our heart, the desires of our heart. We pray the deposit of your truth will be a seed that will germinate and will grow and multiply 100-fold. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, some of you may not know the Lord. And it's a good time if you do not know the Lord and you are in turmoil and struggling and you are like a chef being blown here, being blown there, and you're struggling with the situation, the circumstances of the present time. I encourage you to come to the Lord and take delight in Him, and He will give you His peace, His joy, and above all, His life. He promises to give us abundant life, eternal life. And all you need to do is first acknowledge that you need God, you need Jesus in your life, that you are sinners, you have been separated from Him, and invite Him to come into your heart. Yeah. And some of you, you know, if the Lord has spoken to you, you want to make that commitment, you just put your hand into your heart and say, Lord, today I commit myself to take greater delight in you. So God bless you as you do. And for those of you who do not know the Lord, you can pray a simple prayer following after me. Say, Lord Jesus, I acknowledge I'm a sinner and my life is in a mess, in turmoil. I'm like a chef being blown here, everywhere. I do not experience the peace that surpasses understanding. I now invite you to come into my heart. I believe you died on the cross for me and take away my sin. You have taken away my sin. Come into my heart and be my Savior and my Lord. And I commit myself to following you the rest of my life. Thank you for giving me the gift of eternal life. In Jesus' precious name, amen. So God bless you, all of you. Have a wonderful week. Amen.
Thank you, David. That was so encouraging. And I just want to encourage all of you watching right now that they don't call this God's living word for nothing, right? And it's relevant to us. It helps us. And it is a key way which God connects with us and communicates with us. So I challenge you this morning, just as David did, take an effort, make some time to read God's Word on a daily basis. Memorize Scripture, that's key. Keep it in your heart and you will see how it will transform your life. It's an encouragement to all of you this morning. Let's end this time by reading the Lord's Prayer, and after that, let me pray the benediction over you. Let's read this together. Our Father in heaven, help us to honor your name. Come and set up your kingdom so that everyone on earth will obey you, as you are obeyed in heaven. Give us our food for today. Forgive us for doing wrong, as we forgive others. Keep us from being tempted and protect us from evil. For yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Let's stand in a posture of prayer as I pray over you and pray for you. And now may the God of peace, who raised from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, our Savior, by whose blood we have God's everlasting covenant, also equip you with all that you need to do His will in every good work. God working in you what is pleasing to Him through Jesus Christ, to whom be glory forever and ever. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up His countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. Have a good week ahead. I want to encourage you, reach out to somebody, a friend who you feel needs the touch of the Lord this morning. Reach out to a Connect Group member. Drop them a message. Say hi. It means a lot during this MCO time. God bless you. See you in the midweek prayer. Keep up on the chats. And do post some feedback and comment on the FB page, okay? So that we know I can hear from you and get some real-time feedback. God bless you all. Have a good week ahead. Amen.
washed away my sin. What can make me whole again? What can make me white as snow? Nothing but your royal blood. What can wash away my sin? What can make me whole again? What can make me white as snow? Nothing but your royal blood. What can heal the heart of stone? What can resurrect these bones? There's no other fount I know. Nothing but your royal blood. What can heal the heart of stone? What can resurrect these bones? There's no other fount I know. Nothing but your royal blood. Nothing but your royal blood. Your blood will never lose its power. Your blood will never lose. Your victory will stand forever. Your blood will never lose. Yeah, yeah. Never fail me yet. This was won upon the cross. This was written on his scars. This has made us conquerors. Nothing but your royal blood. Oh, nothing but your royal blood. Come on, your blood will.
Now by this.